Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We are here with General PJS Pannu, who is the Deputy Chief of Integrated Defence Staff of the Government of India. And we are going to talk about, you know, all and whatever is about the cyber world and its influence on the forces of today's world, and how does it help to make war and peace. So we'll go ahead. There's no wasting time between the two of us. So we'll go ahead with General Pannu. General Pannu, we'd like you to talk about all that you've been speaking about since the morning.
Good morning. I'm very happy to be talking on the subject, because it is not only for the military. I think it is for the whole humanity to understand that we from the industrial age have shifted to the information age. So therefore, the machine has become an equal partner, and slowly we're going to outsource more to the machine, and therefore there are concerns as to how human being is going to deal with these machines, not only in day-to-day life, in industry, in business, in the teaching methodologies, training, and our future generations are going to be more ready because they are more interfaced, they've been brought up using machines. So our future generation obviously would be more savvy to deal with the issues of space, cyber technology, materials and all that. Now, having spoken about it, when you talk about warfare really is nothing that the military does separately as far as technology is concerned. Most of the technology comes from the industry and the research laboratories. Today, the electronics, the digitization, the miniaturization, and the speed of doing things has undergone a phenomenal change. We are in the era of accelerated acceleration. Whatever our past generations did in 2 years, I suppose we would be doing in a month or maybe lesser than that. So therefore, the speed of growth in the future is such that we have to cope up with that. So therefore, anybody who has learned something today and operates a machine today, there is a fair amount of chance that you would always be outdated by somebody else, and you won't be aware of it that you've been outdated, and there is something else which is there on the shelf, and the change is going to be very rapid, and we have to cope with it even in warfare. As far as the cyber warfare is concerned, obviously we're talking about the computers, we're talking about network systems, and we are talking about system of systems, and then it starts from your day-to-day operations and how you're going to use the computers for future. And therefore, very quickly, when you go into the cyber world, you start talking about machine learning, because computer-aided designs, computer-aided solutions, and computer-aided warfare will bring you to the realm of the informatization of the entire environment, and therefore informatization of warfare. So in this environment, we are talking about how the technology is going to make us fight future wars. Future wars are going to be rapid, more complex, but if the artificial intelligence steps in, as very quickly it is stepping in, there's going to be a huge question as to what is the role of human being in the artificial intelligence, because the machines will talk to machines and machines will learn from each other, but the programming still will be in the hands of a human being, because the desires are not in the machine, the desires are in the human being. So anybody who's got a desire would want the machine to fulfill that desire, and therefore the objectives. So therefore the scare that the machines will automatically do things, I think there is going to be a limitation, because the machines do not have emotions. Artificial intelligence is going to be only as much as the machine can do without the emotions. So the EQ portion cannot completely replace the IQ. And therefore, the EQ and the SQ that we talk about are going to still remain a human preserve. So therefore, the machine and man will undergo a different relationship. A lot of outsourcing will happen, and the forces will become more lean and mean. Lean would mean that lesser manpower would be used, and mean would mean that the machines would replace the beast, because as in the past we've used man and a beast combination, and in future is going to be a man and a machine combination. So therefore the future is going to be with technology, miniaturization, we are going to be having the satellites do a lot of jobs for us in faster communications, into intelligence, surveillance and reconnaissance, into talking to the satellite to satellite, maybe at some point storage of data. But also there is a challenge in the space, because increasingly the number of satellites which are going up from different countries is so huge, and the debris which is coming up in the space is also going to be so huge that maybe at some point we should not land up creating a situation which is there on the Earth today, because our population, which was almost 1 billion at the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, today has gone to 7.7 billion. And in next 30 years, we're going to add 2 more billion people to this Earth. So the Earth is already congested, and the resources are at premium. The exploration of our natural resources is going on, not only by the human effort, but by the machine effort. And more we outsource to the machine, I suppose it'll gobble up more resources of the Earth, and therefore we will face challenges of natural calamities and disasters, because the nature also does self-balancing. And in self-balancing, you find that the global warming, the flood situations coming up, the glaciers melting, the sea levels going up, some islands disappearing. And of course, the technology steps in and technology starts interfering with weather, because a lot of EM spectrum is likely to be used for change of climate, which has been demonstrated by some countries. I think there has to be a regulation that the technology should not be used anywhere or permitted to be used to alter the nature. If you play with the nature, obviously, I think nature is likely to remain supreme, and nature might come back to hit us. So therefore, it is not going to be a warfare between man to man and nation to nation. We should not create a situation that the man is up against the nature, and the warfare is of a different kind between nature and the human being.
In the morning, sir, you mentioned one phrase which was very interesting, Internet of Military Things. What does it mean?
When you talk about the Internet of Things, obviously you're talking about the use of smart gadgets which are networked. And these smart gadgets really talk about the systems in which you can be connected with a virtual world. You can operate things from a distance in a remote manner. You can be in touch with people who are not with you. You can discuss with them in real time, whatever you want. You can actually see what's happening in areas where you're not there. So as a result, what will happen is that the number of IP addresses are going to grow. And these IP addresses obviously are going to work in every room. Maybe you will have one or two IP addresses. In a house, you may have 30 to 40 IP addresses. And therefore, the ground infrastructure has to be prepared. The ground-to-ground communication, ground-to-space communication, all that will have to be factored in. And therefore, those to increase those capacities, I suppose the whole world is gradually shifting to 5G. So when you shift to 5G, obviously you talk about Internet of Military Things also in that. And therefore, the way 5G and the IoT is going to happen, not only the military, but if the same thing is adopted by the military and adapted by the system, it will become international Internet of Military Things. It means all your systems, which are autonomous or semi-autonomous, will increasingly get connected. So I suppose that is how, when so many IP addresses work in the battlefield, would be Internet of Military Things, as it would be Internet of Commercial Things, Internet of Financial Things, Internet of Banking Things. So, you know, whatever discipline is there, all that you do is after I-O, you put that, and then it is of things. So I suppose Internet of Industrial Things is also something which is going to proceed the Internet of Military Things.